Belinda Audiobooks presents this unabridged recording of Goodoo Goodoo, written by Robert G. Barrett. Be sure to visit our website at www.belinda.com. Details of other available and forthcoming Belinda audiobook releases can be found at the end of this recording. Belinda Audio wishes to advise that this audiobook contains strong language and adult themes, which may be offensive to some listeners. Dedication. This book is dedicated to gold medalist Heather Turland. If what she accomplished and how she accomplished it isn't an inspiration to all Australians, nothing is. As far as Norton was concerned, life was definitely worth living. You just took the good with the bad, the yin with the yang, and you couldn't go wrong. Yes, the big red-headed Queenslander smiled to himself as he took another mouthful of orange juice, wriggled his backside around on his lounge, and gazed across at the TV flickering away on the other side of the room. You wouldn't be dead for quids, would you? You wouldn't be Elvis or Aristotle Onassis for all their money. It was a cool Tuesday evening at the start of another winter in Sydney. The sun had tucked itself into bed about an hour previous, and outside it was cloudy with one of the many brisk sou'westers to come, whipping across the roofs, along the streets, then over the white sands of famous Bondi Beach and out to sea. Norton was seated comfortably in his lounge room, wearing an old blue tracksuit, watching the early news on TV, and not worrying all that much about the chilly weather outside. In the morning, he was jetting off to sunny Cairns to go whitewater rafting, but in about an hour's time, he was going down the beachfront to try his hand at something completely different. Norton smiled to himself again as a raft of commercials appeared on the screen. Yes. All you have to do is roll with the punches and take the good with the bad. He raised his glass of OJ and winked up at the sky outside. And if it's okay with you, boss, I'll take good over bad any time. Les was still seeing Taekwondo Kate on a fairly regular basis, although she always seemed to keep him just a little at arm's length. However, her two big, ugly brothers still gave Norton the impression they'd like to have him dangling on a length of rope. Catherine genuinely liked Les, and she knew Norton's feelings for her, but somehow, between Norton's unsavoury employment background and the tie-in with Nazegi, who was subsequently busted huge time, she had put two and two together and had half convinced herself that Les might have been involved. And speaking of Neville Nazegi, somehow it appeared the rotten swine had allegedly escaped. He was allegedly well and truly in the hands of the constabulary one minute, the next minute he allegedly wasn't. It made great headlines, and the media had a field day with it. He was alleged to have gotten away in a helicopter, alleged to have dug a tunnel out of Long Bay in record time, been kidnapped by allegedly crooked prison warders and corrupt police who allegedly tortured him to try and find out where the rest of the loot was. The mail Norton and the team at the Kelly Club got was a little different. Evidently, there was a huge blow-up between the federal police, the New South Wales police, and everybody else involved. They all swooped on the garage in Coogee at once and were all forced to count the loot in front of each other, so no one could get any of it. There was no shortage of allegations and nasty words flying around between the parties involved, and somehow, in between the allegations and nasty words, Nazegi allegedly vanished. In the course of their inquiries, two detectives called in to have a word with Les late one afternoon. Their timing couldn't have been better. Kathy happened to have called in earlier as well, and it was the first time she'd ever seen two New South Wales detectives in full attack mode. Guns on hips, notebooks at the ready. As well as giving Les the third degree, they even asked Kathy her name and address and where she was at the time. But what could Les tell them? Only the truth. If they didn't believe him, they could check the hotel register in Wagga Wagga and watch the grand final replay on TV. The tape was there with the others. However, he had absolutely nothing to do with the big Russian getting poisoned. The cops had left reasonably satisfied, and Kathy had left reasonably unsatisfied. So, even though Les had fluked himself a nice little earner when he accidentally found the Krugerrands in Nazeggy's other garage, he reckoned it might not be such a good idea to go cashing them in around town for the time being. So he had left them buried in the backyard with the rest of the loot. There was no doubt it was as good as money in the bank, and who knew what the price of gold might be a year or so down the track. He had also finally got his precious rock pool finished. The tiles he ended up buying were that close to matching, it didn't matter. So if he came across the Irish scaffolder again, he could tell him to stick the original ones, if he ever found them, fair up his sweet Rosie O'Grady. His old mate with the monster boobs, Evelyn, was still keen, and she was right about the ABC. Evelyn was now back nursing at a private hospital in Chatswood. So between her shift work and Norton's shift work and Kathy keeping him shifted to the side a bit, Les was getting enough KFC, kind female companions, to keep him more than happy. And despite Kathy not quite flinging herself down in front of Les, ripping off her knickers and screaming at her undying love for him, she'd still split the bill sometimes if they went out for dinner, or do him a favour now and again. For instance, of late, and for a lousy $100, she had got Les 2 days at a nice resort in Cairns, bumped up to business class in the plane, and a day's whitewater rafting thrown in. Kathy was going to some travel agents' convention on the Gold Coast, and part of the contra deal for the agency was a spare ticket. She told Les that if he was interested, it was his for 100 simoleons. Les made Kathy repeat, with her hand across her heart, that this was all strictly honest and there was definitely no shenanigans involved. She had said yes, and so he took it. Kathy had already been gone 3 days, and Les had taken the whole week off from work, getting Big Danny to stand in for him. But in the meantime, Les had scored a gig as a guest disc jockey on a small FM radio station that had opened up in Bondi, working out of the Bondi Hotel. The station was run on a shoestring budget, and on a good day, the band reached across Curlewa Street and to the second line of breakers off the beach. Somehow it worked its way up to Cox Avenue, where Warren picked it up first, and now they both listened to it. Mainly because it had catchy jingles, bugger all ads, and didn't play any of that horrible baby boomer music the other FM stations like to soak you with. 99 FM was also starting to get quite a cult following around the eastern suburbs. And if there was one thing both Les and Warren liked, it was having a cult to follow. For a bit of a promotion, the station ran a quiz. Idea being, you rang up, and if you were the first to answer, you won the gig, plus $10 and a T-shirt. The question was, who was John Simon Ritchie, and what band did he play in? Les knew that. Sid Vicious, and the band was the Sex Pistols. Les rang up, and the next thing he knew, he'd won a 99 FM T-shirt, his cheque was in the mail, and he was going on air the following Tuesday, which was today, at 7. This suited Norton admirably. He had to be up around 6 to get to the airport with plenty of time to catch his flight, so he could be home, have a mug of Ovaltine, and be in bed with his teddy bear by 11 at the latest. He smiled across at the flickering TV again. Les Norton, disc jockey. He liked the sound of that. Or what about Les Norton, radio announcer? That was even better. Or the Les Norton Show on 99 FM. No, he had a better idea. Wolfman Les. Yeah, that was it. He finished his orange juice and reached across for the remote. Whatever I call myself, I better get my finger out, he thought. Warren will be home from the Acme House for the mentally deficient shortly, and by the time I get my shit together, it'll be showtime. He zapped the TV set, then got up, strolled out to the kitchen and rinsed his glass. Before long, Les was showered, had the CDs picked out for his gig, and everything packed for his 2 days in Cairns, with time left over for a cup of coffee. He was sitting in the kitchen wearing his comfiest jeans, a white FM stereo 107.1 T-shirt the mud crabs had sent him from Wagga Wagga, and the East German Navy jacket he had conned off the big Russian, when Warren arrived home and walked into the kitchen. "Well, well, well," said Norton, glancing up from his coffee. Warren was sporting a double-breasted char-grey suit, a purple shirt, a purple and yellow tie, and a pair of grey suede cowboy boots.
If it isn't Brian Ferry himself. How's it going, Brian? Still got the shits because Jerry left you for old rubber lips?
Get fucked, Les, replied Warren. You don't have to go to meetings with clients who are Italian and fucking cunts as well.
He looked across at the Kelvinator.
Any piss left in the fridge?
Yeah, heaps. Get into it.
Warren went to open the fridge, then changed his mind.
Ah, fuck piss. I need something stronger. A vodka. Stolly, sweetie,
purred Les.
Or wouldn't a hot shot advertising executive like you prefer a martini at this time of the day?
No. I'll have a schooner, a fucking paint stripper with a pubic hair in it, you fucking hillbilly.
Suit yourself.
Les settled back with his coffee while Warren got a bottle of Russian Ultra from the lounge room, splashed some into a tall glass, rattled a few lumps of ice and red grapefruit juice in it, then took a healthy slurp.
Oh, yeah. That's better.
Warren took another sip, then sat down at the kitchen table opposite Les. He took another sip, then looked at Norton over his glass.
Hey, aren't you going disc jockeying or something tonight?
That's right, nodded Les. A rickapoodley and a fang doogly. This is Wolfman Les. So sit back at ease or get down on your knees, because I got the CDs that please. Ow, ow, ow!
Warren nodded enthusiastically.
Yeah, that's it, Les. Why don't you go on air just like that? Do it, baby.
You'd like me to, wouldn't you, Woz? Go in the station and make a complete wally of myself?
You can't do anyway. In fact, what are they paying you? $10?
Warren pulled a 20 from his pocket.
I'll give you another 20 if you'll say that, then play Heaven is a Place on Earth by Belinda Carlisle and Sugar Baby Love by the Rubettes, back to back.
Norton looked impassively at Warren for a moment.
I'll tell you what I might play, smartass, he said. How about the Rentman Blues? If you can afford to throw $20 bills around, you can afford to weigh in more at the end of the week. I'm putting the rent up.
What?
Warren slumped back in his chair, horrified.
No, Les, you can't. I'm in enough shit as it is. It'd break me.
Are you fair dinkum?
Norton matched Warren's look of horror with one of controlled outrage.
Christ! When was the last time I put the rent up? They still had horse-drawn trams going up and down George Street.
You can't, Les. You just can't.
Warren shook his head sadly, took another drink and quickly changed the subject.
Would you believe I have to get up at 3:30 tomorrow morning?
Shit. I haven't forced you into doing burglaries, have I?
We're driving up to the Blue Mountains in a Holden to find a location to shoot an ad for a fucking Volvo.
This time of the year? Norton shivered. I'm glad it's you and not me.
Yeah. What about you, you cunt? You want to make life a misery for me, and you're going to Cairns in the morning? How's your form?
Les nodded.
Yep. Fun in the sun for Uncle Les.
Norton rose from the kitchen table and buttoned up his jacket.
But no matter where I'm going tomorrow, right now, I've got to go DJing.
He rinsed his coffee cup and put it next to the sink.
I'll discuss the rent issue with you when I return.
Yeah, do that, replied Warren. I'll be in bed, asleep.
Okay. Well, there's a cassette in the stereo. Will you tape this for me so I can have a listen when I get home?
Righto.
Thanks, Woz.
Les gave his flatmate a smile.
If I don't see you before, I'll see you when I get back from Cairns.
Go get him, Wolfman. Have a good trip.
Les picked up his bag of CDs and went out the front door, closing it quietly behind him. It took Les about 10 minutes to walk down to the Bondi Hotel. It was still early on this cool Tuesday night, and there weren't many people around. Les walked straight in the Campbell Parade entrance through the old wooden doors with the shiny brass fittings, glanced at the girl behind the desk in the lobby, who didn't seem to notice him, then stopped in front of the lift doors and pressed the button. There was no movement, and there was still no movement about 3 minutes later. Les gave the lift a brief once up and down. It looked like something out of an old black-and-white movie. Any minute, Les expected the doors to open and Sydney Greenstreet would walk out, followed by Peter Lorre or Humphrey Bogart carrying the Maltese Falcon. There was a carpeted set of stairs with freshly painted light green walls on his left. Les gave the lift another minute, then started climbing. In next to no time, he was on the third floor landing. There were rooms on either side of the landing, and there was a balcony ahead. Les walked out and had a look around. Campbell Parade was on the left. There were buildings in front of him, and where the hotel angled out from the balcony on his right, Les saw a red neon sign saying, "On Air."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.